Wherever you are, make it Truth Frequency Radio.
This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to be. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes.
Listening to the Revolutionary Radio Project with your host, Rob Skiba.
All I'm offering is the truth.
Hello and welcome to the Revolutionary Radio Project. I am your host, Rob Skiba, and tonight I have a return guest to the Revolutionary Radio Project. It's my friend Josh Peck, and since he's been here before, we'll just go ahead and get right to it. Josh, are you there?
Yes, I am. How you doing, Rob?
Good. Great to have you back, man.
It's great to be back. It's always a blessing. It's always good to talk to you.
Yeah, likewise. So you've become quite the prolific writer these days. How many books you got out now?
Well, I have three major ones, Disclosure, Quantum Creation, and now Cherubim Chariots. And I have about five mini study books, an anthology, a gospel harmony, probably some other stuff mixed in there. I keep pretty busy.
Yeah, good for you. I'm excited about it. I saw the cover for your book. That's rather impressive. Did you do your cover, or did you have somebody do that for you?
Oh, no, my good friend of mine did it for me. She's a phenomenal graphic artist. If people want information on her or are looking for a graphic artist, they can find her information. I have it on my Facebook page and also in the book. But, yeah, she does phenomenal work. She did the cover to Quantum Creation as well.
Oh, awesome. So I've had you on the program before talking about Quantum Creation, and you sent out an email blast to a bunch of us regarding your new release. Why don't you tell us a little bit about why did you write that book in the first place? What prompted you to go that direction on Cherubim?
Sure. Yeah, sure. Well, in Quantum Creation, I had a chapter that was kind of dedicated to the idea that UFOs might have extra dimensional properties. And, I always found that to be really interesting, and I wanted to write more than just one chapter, but for that book, you know, I had to limit it to just a chapter. So, I had all this research for that, and I decided, well, I'll just put this into another book. And, you know, I've always wanted to really get into, that area and haven't really had the opportunity. So, that was really what, kind of springboarded me into this topic was all the research I did in quantum physics and everything for Quantum Creation really helped for me explain a lot about UFOs and supposed aliens and, you know, angels and all of that stuff. So that's kind of what led me to do this.
So what you're saying is this is basically a 227-page elaboration on something you said in your previous book.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's exactly what Archon Invasion was. A 366-page elaboration of chapter one of my first book.
That's awesome. You know, and it's interesting you bring that up too, because time and time again throughout Cherubim Chariots, I found myself covering a lot of similar ground that you've covered in your research. So, at least three or four different times that happened in the writing of this book. So that was pretty cool. I wasn't really trying for that, but it just kind of happened.
You know, it is interesting. A lot of us that run in similar circles of research, it is weird how we all tend to sort of be on the same topic independent. I'm so busy doing my own stuff. I don't hardly communicate with anybody else, you know, out there. So it's not like I'm saying, hey, Josh, what are you researching? Oh yeah, I think I'll look into it too.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Same here. I'm usually, cause a lot of the stuff that people are researching will come through their blogs and, if they have a podcast or something, it'll come through that before it's even published in a book.
Yeah.
And, you know, unfortunately, you know, a lot of them that have them are good friends of mine. I just don't have time to keep up on everybody's stuff. But, yeah, and total coincidence, the chapter headers, the pictures that I use for the chapter headers in the book, came from the same image that Tom Horn and Chris Putnam are using in their new book, right on the cover. And, so I thought that was kind of a funny, coincidence, because, Chris Putnam put in an interview, for this book. But, I didn't even see the cover until after I had the book published, and I was like, whoa. If I would have known that, I might have changed it, but it's a little late now.
Talking about the chimeric, Nimrod beasts.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, it is interesting. You know, it makes me wonder, you know, talk about quantum physics and quantum creation. If maybe, God's not out there sending out signals and, those who are tuned into the radio station are just kind of picking up on, you know, bits and pieces of it, because it is so bizarre. I mean, it's happened so many times where, you know, I'll be researching and find out that, you know, you are or somebody else is or, you know, any number of people are actually all kind of tuned into that same frequency for that particular period of time. So it makes you wonder, especially considering the subject matter we're going to be talking about tonight, if this isn't preparation for something.
Yeah, I believe so. I mean, it's just too much. I don't believe in coincidence anyway, but even if coincidence is a real thing, this is just too much of a coincidence. Cause, you know, it's not even just you and I. There's a lot of researchers out there that are in this fringe thing, that are looking into this stuff. And it does come up time and time again. It's kind of fun. Every single book I've put out, I've had to worry like, oh, I hope this author or that, you know, that researcher doesn't think I'm stealing their stuff, because turns out, you know, it's along similar lines. I would agree with that. I think, you know, it's inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and it's the same spirit. So it's right. The same revelation. So yeah.
Yeah. And you know, people get so wrapped around the axle about thinking it's theirs. You know, this is mine. You know, I found it first. It's kind of like, you know,
oh yeah,
it's in a competition.
Exactly. I can't stand that, because we're all supposed to be fighting for the same team, and it's ultimately God's anyway.
Right.
You know, I mean, like if somebody found something from my book or podcast or, you know, whatever, a blog, and they wrote about it in their book and didn't give me credit. Honestly, it wouldn't bother me. I'd just be happy that information, if, you know, for one thing, I would take it as confirmation that another author or researcher found something that I did. But, also, you know, what are we doing this for? Are we doing it for credit and the very little bit of money that we might get if we're lucky? Or are we doing it to get the truth out there and to help prepare people? You know, that's what should be, first and foremost. So, you know, on the rare occasion that I've ever seen anybody have something similar to mine, I think it's great. I mean, it's all God's anyway. He can do what he want with it.
Yeah. It is good, confirmation when you see something like that. You're kind of like, you know, when, I don't know about you, but when I'm in research mode, I got to shut off like my phone. I don't hardly check my email. I certainly don't get on Facebook. I got to limit the time suckers, you know, cause I'm like totally in the zone doing that. So it's like, no, you know, I'm not. So, you know, I'm in the zone doing that. And then I come out and see somebody else's writing. In fact, I did the Yahuwah Triangle series back in December, and somebody just recently sent me a book that looks like they published several years ago, actually, and they didn't leave a note, they didn't leave anything, but I can only assume that they must have watched my video or something, found my contact information, and sent it to me. And I just sort of flipped through the book, and I'm like, wow, you know, several years ago this guy was coming to the exact same conclusions that I had just recently come to, and I never saw his or ever heard of this guy.
Oh, wow.
I just took it as, you know what, this is really cool confirmation. In fact, I probably need to schedule him to come on the show. But I was looking through the chapter titles of your book, and it does look like we got some interesting crossover stuff to talk about. So I'm ready to dive in, man. Well, let's start with the title, Cherubim Chariots. Who or what are the cherubim? Let's start there.
That's a great place to start. And that was one of the first things that I had to – That's actually the first thing that I address in the book is who are these cherubim and what do they have to do with us? And it really goes back to the garden. And before we can really understand what the purpose of the cherubim are, well, I guess I can start by saying with I see things like angels and spiritual entities as synonymous with extra dimensional entities. I think spiritual and extra dimensional basically means the same thing when we use it in that sort of context. And we talked about that when I was on talking about quantum creation. So I use the same terminology throughout this book, and a lot of times I'll say something's extra dimensional and you could put angelic or spiritual in there and it's fine. But what it seems like is things that, extra dimensional entities or angelic or whatever, they seem to be classified more by their job than what they look like. Because things like, excuse me, things like a cherubim, they have different, I guess we would call them physical attributes from our perspective. But basically, you know, if we were to see one, we would see some sort of amalgamation of, animal and human, but it always seems to be kind of different. What I believe really defines a cherubim is the job, the task that it has, and it seems to be to protect. So the first mention that we see of cherubim in the Bible is in the book of Genesis. And, after Adam and Eve rebelled, God expelled them from the Garden of Eden. And after that, he placed cherubim in the garden to protect the tree of life. And, we get that from Genesis 3:24, which says, "So he drove out the man and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life." A really interesting thing to know, and you know, this book I really could call a book of speculations, because I speculate a lot in this book, but you know, there's always some basis for it, but I kind of went that route. But an interesting thing to note is the word east there in the original text. East comes from, and I'm not a Hebrew scholar at all, so I'll probably butcher these words, but comes from the Hebrew word kedem. And, has a double meaning. Most times it just means east, you know, like the direction. And on the surface, that seems to be the right translation in the proper context. But, kedem could also mean, ancient, aforetime, earliest time, and beginning among others. The word kedem is used to describe an attribute of God in Deuteronomy 33:27, which says, "The eternal God is thy refuge." So that word eternal was translated from the Hebrew word kedem, where east from Genesis comes, was translated from. So that right there in Deuteronomy shows the timeless attribute of God, and describing God as eternal conveys the idea that he's outside of time, itself. He has no beginning or end. So that might help explain what I believe to be an aspect of creation that's not commonly considered. I've heard Chuck Missler talk about it and a couple others, but it's not, you know, you're not gonna hear it in any church probably, but earlier in the book of Genesis, in Genesis 2:8, it says, "And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed." So the word planted comes from, the word planted comes from the Hebrew word nada and means established. And we see that word eastward again, and it comes from kedem again. Now, that could be conveying the idea that the garden itself was originally established in a place outside of time and space as we know it. And that's kind of weird, but you know, the fact that the fact that the garden itself has a beginning, it disqualifies it from being truly eternal. You know, it was created, so it had a beginning. But it could be showing that it originated from a state outside of the normal flow of time, or at least outside of dimensional space. And that could be an attempt to describe a place of a different space time than we're familiar with. So the Garden of Eden may have originated from a higher dimension. And if that's true, that could help explain why Adam and Eve were expelled from the garden. There's a theory, and I'm sure you've heard, I think I first heard it from Chuck Missler probably, that states before Before Adam and Eve fell, they had access to all dimensions of created time and space. And at the time of the rebellion, there was a split in the dimensions. Then Adam and Eve were left, you know, fallen to the three dimensions of space and one of time that we're familiar with now. And the rest of the higher dimensions became inaccessible. And I always thought that was a really interesting idea, but I didn't know how much there really was in the Bible to base, you know, something like that from until I really started, looking into these Hebrew words. But that also might help explain the purpose of the tree of life. So before the fall, Adam and Eve were free to eat of any tree except for the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And that means they were free to eat from the tree of life since it was already present in the garden. So if the fruit from the tree of life was there to sustain their state in eternity, that might help explain why they were denied access to the tree of life after they fell. Adam was told if he were to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, he would surely die. That's in Genesis 2:17. So if Adam and Eve were to eat from the fruit of the tree of life after they fell, they would have been in an eternal state of death, I believe. Mm-hmm. They would have been comparable to a demon or fallen angel or something. They wouldn't have had any chance of redemption. This is a long-winded answer to your question, but that brings us to the cherubim and what they are. Genesis 3:24 tells us that the cherubim guarded the garden along with a flaming sword which turned every which way to keep the way of the tree of life. So the text doesn't necessarily say that the cherubim were handling the sword. You know, we might get that image in our mind, but it's not that specific. It only states that one was placed there, that a sword was placed there. And the turning every way aspect seems to come directly from the sword itself. It doesn't seem to be caused by the cherubim. So it seems that whatever that sword actually was, its purpose was to make it impossible for Adam and Eve to enter the garden again and have access to the tree of life. That sword may have been what was used to cause the split in dimensions of space and time. It wasn't until after Adam and Eve were driven out of the garden that sword was set in place. And if that's true, that could help explain why the Garden of Eden has never been found. I believe it's possible that it exists in a state that we no longer have access to. It's contained in a higher dimension than our own. It could be that the garden is still here on Earth, but because of our limited perception, we could walk right through it and never even know it. So I believe it's possible, and it's a theory I explore in the book that the sword and the cherubim are still performing their duty. So the garden remains inaccessible. So that kind of helps explain where we're coming from when we talk about who the cherubim are, you know, and their job of protecting things and we see that in ancient architecture too. Things like, the Shadu and Lamassu, the statue of, they're basically cherubim, you know, they're called by different names in different cultures, but there are these statues that were placed in the, palace doorways and things to, help guard and protect it. So really long-winded answer I gave you there, Rob.
Man, I like, you know, I've always loved the idea of the first lightsaber-wielding character being in Genesis, but this puts it on a whole totally different dimension of consideration. Fascinating. I deal with the Garden of Eden in my second video of the Yahuwah Triangle series, but I don't really get into it nearly like what in the direction that you're taking it. Mm-hmm. I'm just talking about the location of where it was.
Right.
But the idea that it could simultaneously still be existing, in its original Genesis state, even to this day, simply, imperceptible to us due to the activity of the cherubim and the first lightsaber. I think that's pretty fascinating, frankly. I'd like to know, how much do you get into that in your book, or you just kind of throw it out there?
Oh yeah, I deal with it right off the bat in the whole first chapter, and because I think it's, you know, good to have a foundation right in the beginning, especially when we're talking about like eternal beings and things like that. And it's something I reference here and there throughout the book. But, yeah, it all goes back to the garden. And, cause that's one of the biggest questions is, you know, where is the Garden of Eden? Was it destroyed in the flood? Was it taken up to heaven? And, you know, it seems, just on a surface reading, it seems like the Bible just isn't really, that descriptive of what happened to it. So most people pass it off as, you know, well, it's not that important or, and then the, you know, few that do research it, you know, come up with different answers and they're all interesting. I've read a lot of different theories of where it might be located and, they're all fascinating. I've always been fascinated with it, but when I really looked into it myself I didn't really look at it from this angle until after I wrote Quantum Creation, because you know, that kind of opened my eyes to that whole thing, and I started thinking, well, you know, when this was created, nothing was fallen yet. What does it mean to be fallen? Because, you know, I put forth the idea in Quantum Creation that it's possible when the angels fell, you know, it might not be a falling, you know, falling from the sky to earth, you know, like what we would think of as normal falling, but it might be like a demotion of dimensions, like they might have fallen to the fourth dimension, and you know, we already talked about all that. But so when I thought about, okay, well, Adam and Eve were fallen, they were driven out of the garden. What about the garden? You know, was the garden fallen? You know, the tree of life was still there, and they still had access to it, and they still potentially could have had access to it if they weren't driven out. The tree itself couldn't have been corrupted or fallen because it still would have worked as, you know, it was meant to. So if the garden never fell or never, if it was somehow shielded from that sin, then it still might be in that eternal-ish high dimensional state.
I can't wait for you to see the second video.
Yeah, I saw the first one, and even that, my kids were going crazy through the whole thing, and I had to keep pause. I got to go back and rewatch it. But from what I caught, it was mostly the pyramid.
Yeah, that one thing. Dealing with Egypt and the pyramid. The second one, though, it's devoted to the location and biblical confirmation of the location of Eden. But
that's awesome.
I think. I'm excited to dive. I haven't read your book yet. I mean, you sent it to me. I just haven't had time to look at it. That's why I wanted to really talk with you. Because I think, from what you're saying, it sounds like you're going to have a lot of really interesting insight that I could then add, from you to the work that I've already done in terms of my understanding of it. And probably vice versa. Because if what I've discovered is true, and if what you've discovered is true, that's pretty hugely significant. And it also, and I know you kind of touched on Mount Hermon too, we can get to that as well, but before we go there, I want to, ask you a question regarding the, well, two things. If they were already immortal, I contend that Adam and Eve were immortal until they took of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and that's when they became mortal. But so if that's true, and if they were already immortal, what would have happened, or what would have been the benefit of eating from the tree of life if they were already immortal?
The only thing sinning. Yeah, the only thing that I can come up with is it might have sustained that, you know, it might have somehow sustained their immortality in some way. I don't really know, you know, exactly. There's a lot of different schools of thought regarding that. But it also might have just been an obedience thing, you know.
Yeah.
For all we know that was the only thing that they ate, you know. We're not specifically told. That might have been their only source of sustenance was that. I mean, we're just not told specifically. So there's, you know, there's different ideas about that, but, I don't know. What do you think?
Well, you know, I haven't given it a whole lot of thought myself. It just kind of popped in my head as you were talking. I tend to think it may have also been, you know, the leaves are for the healing of the nations we read in the book of Revelation.
Yeah.
So, you know, could have been possibly, you know, what if they fell down or got hurt or something? You know, maybe it was a quick healing you know, fruit of some sort. But the idea that it could have been their only sustenance is also plausible, I would think. It's just fascinating to think of. I mean, we don't get a whole lot of detail to work on. So, and I say the same thing. Look, it's speculation. You know, where scripture is silent and where other ancient texts aren't telling us, you know, all we can do as researchers is look at the available evidence and try to put together a picture that we think makes sense. But I just think it's fun to talk about, man.
Yeah, me too.
So, you know, it talks about cherubim and now beam or im in Hebrew, where you have the im ending, it indicates a plurality. Do you think that there was more than one cherub? Or do you think that it indicates the plurality of their composition?
Now that's interesting too, because when I've thought about that, are they separate as in like what John saw in Revelation, or are they kind of melded together like in Ezekiel?
Yeah.
I think that one thing I dedicate a whole chapter to Ezekiel and really tear that apart, and really try to explain what's going on there. I think for the Garden of Eden, if it was in its high dimensional state, they would have been separate. I think when John saw the cherubim separate, he was seeing them in, you know, like their natural habitat, I guess we could call it, when, you know, in heaven, basically. I believe that the reason Ezekiel, why they were melded like that, why he saw it like that, I think he saw what is sometimes in physics called an extra dimensional unfolding, where basically, I'm sure we'll get into that in detail later, but, basically if you have something of a higher dimension unfold into a lower dimension, eventually there's going to be parts of that object that take up the same space as other parts. So to someone that has a lower dimensional perspective, like Ezekiel would have had, you know, like we have a three dimensional perspective. It would have looked like they were all melded together, and for all intents and purposes, they were.
All right.
So, that's what I think.
Okay. We'll go to break and come back in a minute and talk about it.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, and that all men are created equal.
The Freedom Link
with Joe Joseph, Monday through Friday, on True Frequency Radio.
And we're back on the Revolutionary Radio Project. I am your host, Rob Skiba, and tonight we are talking with Josh Peck about his new book, Cherubim Chariots. And right before the break, Josh, you were talking about the idea of if we're looking through sort of a multiverse, and entities are coming from the other dimensions, you might have something like an extra dimensional unfolding taking place, wherein from our perspective, it looks like they're melded together. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Interesting. Do you think, you know, when you look at the Ezekiel cherubim, you have the ox, the eagle, the man, and the lion. And I was thinking about that a while back. I was like, okay, you know, if each of these sort of represents a different kingdom of life form on the earth, what's missing? Well, the lizard, the insect, and the fish.
Right.
Do you think that Lucifer may have been of that variety of cherubim?
You know, it may have been, and I've heard theories about that before, and it's definitely interesting. There may have been a fifth cherubim there, and or even sixth and seventh if we add in the fish and insect. And if that's true, here's something. If that's true, and if those are like, I don't know what you'd call them, species, the types of fallen angels, maybe that helps explain the supposed reptilian aliens, right. The mantids, and I mean even the ancient fish gods like Dagon and stuff like that.
Yeah, exactly. That was my thinking on it. It's like, well, you know, why is it when we hear people talk about so-called alien abduction, they seem to be of those variety.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, exactly. That's something I've often wondered about. And, you know, I get the reptilian thing. The mantis ones, though, I don't know what to do with. The closest thing that I can find in scripture is locust, but, you know, locust and mantis, I don't know how close those really are, but, I don't know what to do with them.
Yeah. Well, it's fascinating. Several months back, well, actually, oh, man, I was almost a year ago now, I was able to go to New Jersey and participate in an Ancient Aliens conference where it was the guys from Ancient Aliens, and I was sort of the token Christian there with a different perspective brought in because the event coordinator was a believer, David Stinnett. And he said, you know, I think they're ready for our perspective, you know. And in the course of the dialogue with these people, I mean, even the secular UFO alien researcher is coming to the conclusion that we may be dealing more with extra-dimensional than extraterrestrial. What's the difference between the extraterrestrial hypothesis and the extra-dimensional hypothesis?
Yeah, absolutely. And that right there is the key, because if you can convince somebody to at least explore the possibility of them being extra-dimensional, you're just that much closer to getting them to accept the possibility of a spiritual existence, because they are synonymous. I'm fully convinced of that now. So the extraterrestrial hypothesis is the more mainstream interpretation of what UFOs and their pilots are. The most people in the world that look into this stuff believe that they're beings from another planet, so extraterrestrial. And that, you know, they're coming here for whatever reason. The less popular hypothesis is called the extra dimensional hypothesis, or EDH. Sometimes it's called interdimensional hypothesis, but that's a bit of a misnomer. If they're like, for sake of argument, if there were extraterrestrial species out there in the universe, they could have interdimensional capabilities. If something is truly extra dimensional, it means their origin is from outside of our dimensions of space and time. Mm-hmm. So that the extra dimensional hypothesis is the one that says that these things are most likely from outside of our dimension rather than from another planet. And there's a lot of good reasons to believe that. For one thing, just I talked a little bit about this in Quantum Creation. I talk a lot about it in this one. It's just more plausible to believe that something of a higher dimension is visiting us, which for them would really not require a whole lot of technology. I mean, you know, they'd probably be more advanced than us, sure, but it wouldn't require a whole lot, and it wouldn't require breaking of any physics for an extraterrestrial race to get here from however far away, you know, that they Zeta Reticuli, let's say, because they're the small grays that like to say that they're from there. You would have to break so many laws of physics, it's just ridiculous. It's more plausible to believe. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean it's completely impossible. I mean, from a biblical perspective, I would say, yeah, it's impossible. But just from a straight scientific, you know, sure, maybe scientifically it's theoretically possible that a race could have, you know, advanced to godlike proportions and can do all this stuff. But when we have two possibilities, it just makes more sense to go with what is more likely, what's more simple, you know, Occam's razor. And that, while it might sound more out there, the extra dimensional hypothesis is the simpler one, the easier one, and the one that best explains what people are seeing and experiencing. I mean, people are being pulled through walls. People are seeing UFOs that look solid but change shape. They're able to disappear and reappear, sometimes even show up in two places at once. You know, and it's kind of interesting because when you go down to a subatomic level on a quantum level and look at particles, like in the nucleus of an atom, those particles are doing the same things that these UFOs are doing. You know, they're popping in and out of place. They're showing up in two places at once. And physicists will say, well, those particles are doing that because they're operating in extra dimensions. Well, why not the same for UFOs? So that's what I really explored, and not just from a scientific perspective, but from a biblical perspective too. But I also wanted to write this in a way that would be acceptable and not alienate non-believers. You know, and I believe that I wrote this in a way that a non-believer can pick it up, read it, and not be, you know, they'll probably learn a couple new things about the Bible, but it's not preachy. It's not filled with, you know, all the Christianese and, you know, things like that. So it's accessible to everybody. But I wanted to really look at the EDH from those two perspectives and see what I could come up with. And from a biblical perspective and a scientific perspective, it both seems to agree that the EDH is the most likely one. So that's the difference between the two, and that's what led me to write about that.
Excellent. So it appears that these extra-dimensional beings, angels, cherubim, what have you, or for that matter, God himself, travel in some sort of object.
Yeah.
Chariots of the gods, as von Daniken would say. What conclusions did you come to in that regard? I mean, I believe that I don't, you know, when I look up and see stuff, it is an unidentified flying object.
Yeah.
You know, that's all it means. I mean, it could be a weather balloon. It could be anything, you know, whatever. It's unidentified. We don't know what it is. But when you say UFO today in pop culture, everybody automatically goes to Grays and Zeta Reticuli and whatnot. But if you can steer them in the EDH mode and say, well, no, these entities also have craft.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it really works to our benefit, too, that there are non-believing researchers like Jacques Vallée is a great one that talks about the EDH, and you know, those are great references to cite too when having a discussion with somebody who might not be a believer. But yeah, they definitely seem to have some type of craft, and what you know, it's funny, proponents of the ancient astronaut theory really love to go to Ezekiel because yeah. They you know, they believe that there's a spaceship in there, and in a way there is. I mean, not to what they're saying, because they butcher the text most times. Right. But you know, when you look at it, when you really look at what those wheels within wheels are, this was one of the most phenomenal things. I mean, there was a lot of phenomenal things that came up in researching for this book, but this was one that really stuck with me and got me excited. I've heard a theory that states that UFOs, at least some of them, aren't mechanical at all, but are actually, biological. And it's not a real popular theory, but there are some that believe that. And, you know, I've heard it, and I never really gave it much thought, but that theory sees UFOs as actual living biological entities. So what we see as a metallic craft would be nothing more than, you know, a body for the consciousness or spirit inside, whatever you want to call it. So the more popular version of that theory states that UFOs could be part biological and part mechanical. Now, this is all within the ETH, the extraterrestrial hypothesis. There are a few that believe that. And the idea is that a race of, you know, super intelligent extraterrestrials have found a way to meld living material with non-living physical components. And, you know, it doesn't seem that far-fetched because we're kind of doing that even in our own culture. But the other theory states that it's all biological, and that's the really unpopular one, and that's less recognized as a viable explanation. But when we look at Ezekiel, the idea that an extra-dimensional craft is alive that's not really a new concept at all. It's thousands of years old. Ezekiel described the chariot of the throne of God as being made of living entities. It's even spoke about in the book of Psalms. In Psalm 18:10, it says, speaking about God, it says, "And he rode upon a cherub and did fly, yea, he did fly upon the wings of the wind." Now, you know, when we look at Ezekiel's account, and I could easily take up the rest of the show just talking about that, but I won't. The UFOs that are commonly reported really don't look anything like what Ezekiel reported. You know, there's one aspect though of that heavenly chariot, that does hold a certain resemblance, and it might provide more information, as to if these things are living or not. So, let's see. This would be in Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 15. 15 through 17. I'm going to read this as fast as I can. It talks about the wheels. It says, "Now I beheld the living creatures. Behold, one wheel upon the earth by the living creatures and his four faces. The appearance of the wheels and their work was like unto the color of a barrel, and they four had one likeness, and their appearance and their work was as it were a wheel in the middle of a wheel. And they went upon their four sides, and they turned not when they went." So the word wheels there is actually translated from the Hebrew word ophan, which when you pluralize that, we get the word ophanim. Now, by itself, the Hebrew word ophanim just means wheels, and there's nothing really extraordinary about it. But a lot of times that it's just used for regular, you know, earthly wheels, like found on normal human-made chariots. We even see that word that it describes the wheels of the 10 bases beneath the lavers in Solomon's temple. But when we take the context of this passage in Ezekiel, he's describing something totally different than earthly man-made wheels. He's describing an actual extra-dimensional living being. There is a class of angels called the Ophanim. And they were called that because they look like wheels. You know, like when we say flying saucer, we know we're talking about, you know, alien spaceship or whatever, but I could take a saucer from my cupboard and throw it in the air and technically it's still a flying saucer, you know, so it's
because it looks like that.
Yeah, exactly. And so it just depends on the context that it's used. When Ezekiel uses the word wheels here, he's not talking about earthly wheels. It's actually a class of angel. So, you know, we get more, description. It says, in verse 18, "For their rings, they were so high that they were dreadful, and their rings were full of eyes round about them four." So they had eyes, and those are literal eyes. Even the word rings there comes from the Hebrew word gab, which means the rim of a wheel. So he's definitely describing something that looked like a wheel. It just wasn't at all earth made. There's a interpretation of that, talking about the eyes that says that they were most likely, you know, windows of a craft or something like that. You know, proponents of ancient astronaut theory love to say that. And, you know, at first that might seem plausible. And, I got to give credit to Dr. Michael Heiser for this one because he brought this to my attention, in one of his videos. Ezekiel, if he was trying to describe windows, he could have used the Hebrew word shalom, which actually means window. He had access to words that meant window and door and, you know, all these things he could have used, and he didn't. He didn't use any of them. He used eyes. Like if I'm describing my car door, I'm not going to say it's eye, you know. People would think I was nuts, but I would just say it's window. And it was the same in Ezekiel's time. He had words for all that. So I believe when he said eyes, he literally means eyes. So, when we go further into the chapter, we learn more about the wheels, and it gives a lot of, I'm not gonna read all, there's a lot in there, but it gives a lot of, description, and it tells us the true nature of the Ophanim. They weren't inanimate wheels. They were actually alive. And we know this because Ezekiel tells us that the spirit of the living creatures was in the wheels. And that's from Ezekiel, chapter 1, verse 21. It says the spirit of the living creature was in the wheels. So the wheels themselves acted as like a type of body for the spirits, but the wheels themselves were alive too. So it wasn't just an extra dimensional mechanical construct. The wheels actually had life in them. And, you know, there's ancient, there, like the Book of Enoch talks about the Ophanim as a specific class of angel. And I put the whole passage in the book. I'm not going to read it because it's long, but, I have that in there. So the idea that the Ophanim being an actual class of angel, that's really not, I mean, it was new to me, but that's not a new idea. The Sephardic Jewish philosopher and astronomer Maimonides wrote that the Ophanim are the second class in a hierarchy of angel. Pseudo-Dionysus in the 4th or 5th century wrote that the Ophanim were among the first sphere of angelic hierarchy. You know, so this show, all this shows is that it's not a new idea. This isn't something that I'm just, you know, coming up with and trying to make it fit.
what you're saying, these guys are referring to these as in terms of authority or the word I'm looking for. They're higher ranking classes of angels.
Yeah, exactly. If there's an angelic hierarchy, they're different people throughout history put them in different spots, but they're pretty up there. They're almost basically right below the cherubim themselves. There's one last point with the whole wheels thing. It's been reported, that Ben Rich, the director of Lockheed Skunk Works from 1975 to 1991, he actually admitted publicly that not only are UFOs real, but that they're powered by a type of ESP. If that's true, that might be an example of man's crude attempt of understanding something spiritual through a scientific lens. You know, imagine if we saw today what Ezekiel saw, you know, in the ancient past. If we saw the cherubim seem to move the wheels without touching them, we might assume that it was by a form of ESP. But instead of thinking of it as a power from the mind, maybe we should be thinking of it as a power from the spirit. Right. And there have been reports of that, a lot in ufology, that they're powered somehow by the alien being's mind. It might not be the mind, it might be the spirit, because that's what Ezekiel described as these cherubim powered the spirit was, you know, in the wheels, but the wheels themselves were its own entity as well. The spirit itself, you know, might be the pilot and the vehicle as its body. The way that I look at that is it might be some of these UFOs that are reported, it might be a fallen version of what Ezekiel saw. You know, what Ezekiel saw, the good guys, you know, those were the angels of God. But if different angels from different classes or choirs or whatever you want to call them, if different species of angel fell, maybe some of the Ophanim fell as well, and that might be what some, I don't think all, but at least some of these UFOs might actually be.
Yeah, you know, I would agree with that completely, especially, and it looks like you get into this, I haven't read it, but it looks like you get into the Vimanas and all that kind of stuff, you know, in the ancient record, and even not that far, not that long ago, I mean, In American history, even, you have these various depictions of people writing about what appears to be UFO fights. You know, Star Wars, basically. Ships firing at each other, and whatnot. So, you know, I think when a lot of people, you say fallen angel, they automatically think it's a whole different type of angel. This is an evil, you know, pointy, horned and tail, ugly angel compared to the pretty angel with the white wings. But the reality of it is that they were all godly at one time. There's nothing physically different between a fallen angel and a good angel.
Exactly.
The difference is that their heart attitude and rebellion, you know, what they did. You and I are human beings. We look exactly the same.
Yep.
But our choices determine, you know, whether we're good guys or bad guys. So to the naked eye, we wouldn't know the difference until we saw whatever it was that they were doing, what their activity was. Cause I know, Gary Stearman took a bit of flack for coming out and suggesting that they were, quote unquote, good aliens. Of course, he's talking about angels also.
Yeah.
Cause he describes a UFO encounter where he was flying a single engine plane and he believed that this UFO came alongside him and supernaturally kept his plane in the air when it should have fallen from the sky because of some kind of belt or something in the engine had, fallen off and broken loose or whatever. But I mean, that makes perfect sense to me.
Yeah.
That there would be good ones and there would be bad ones. They would look indistinguishable to us. We wouldn't know the difference until whatever activity that they decided to manifest would reveal, you know, whether they're good guys or bad guys.
Exactly. I couldn't agree more. It's just like if you were to look at a believer and a non-believer, you know, just by looks alone, all you can tell is that they're both human.
Yeah.
I believe it's the same with the angels. I believe it's, you know, the same with the cherubim, the ophanim, you know, whatever class of angel you're looking at. You're not really going to be able to tell just by looking at them. And that's why it says that even Satan, you know, Satan masquerades as an angel of light, that kind of thing. That's how he's able to do that.
Yeah. Yeah. I see you got chapter 2 is, you know, dedicated to, the Vimanas and all that kind of stuff. Do you really get into, the battles and stuff that the ancient world, cultures were writing about, or where did you go with that?
Yeah, we deal with that, and I mostly dealt with the actual descriptions of these Vimana to show, because, you know, a lot of ancient astronaut theorists will use the Mahabharata and things like that to show, well, you know, they're ET craft. But even those texts, it's not extraterrestrial. They are described as extra dimensional. You know, it doesn't use that word, but when we look at them, you know, a really good example is in the Mahabharata, we, find a description of a chariot called the Pushpaka. It's interesting that Sanskrit word has a variety of meanings, and one of them is, a kind of serpent. Mm. So I thought that was interesting. And there's other definitions as well, but, it says in the Mahabharata, and he rode on that beautiful and sky-ranging chariot called the Pushpaka that was capable of going everywhere at the will of the rider. And I think that's interesting wording, you know, at the will of the rider. That might be like the spirit slash ESP kind of thing we were talking about before. But we also learn of the origins. It said the Lord of Treasures sat on that excellent seat, the elegant Pushpaka constructed by Viswakarma, painted with diverse colors. And I deal with all of that in the book of who, Viswakarma was. And I actually believe that that might be Satan. Because interestingly enough, this is a tangent, but, Viswakarma is sometimes referred to as the principal architect of the universe. Now, where does that sound familiar?
Yeah.
You know, in Freemasonry and stuff like that. So I go on that whole tangent in the book. I won't get too much into that here, but,
Well, how does that play into, Vishnu's place at CERN?
Oh yeah, that's skipping ahead a little bit, which is totally fine. I have a whole section in that chapter about Vishnu. Vishnu, he was the Hindu deity of preservation, and what makes this, you know, false god or god lower. I'm just gonna say god just for sake of being brief, but, you know, just understand when I say it, I lowercase g. But what makes this god so interesting is the various avatars. You know, he has 10 avatars, and they're called the Dasha Vatara, and they're described in the Purana Bharati, excuse me. And exactly. It's said that nine of those avatars have already occurred in the past, and the final avatar is going to occur in the, you know, future. It's their eschatology. Well, what's interesting is all those avatars were actually, you know, there's 10 of them. I list them all out in the book. There's the fish, the tortoise, the boar, the half man, half lion, which that's really interesting with Ezekiel.
Okay. Hold that thought.
Yep.
We'll come back and talk about the avatars of fish.
Is Truth Frequency Radio.
The Wicked Ones, obviously under heavy Masonic influence.
We're back on the Revolutionary Radio Project for the second hour. I am your host, Rob Skiba, and we're talking with Josh Peck about his book, Cherubim Chariots. And right before the break, you were describing the various avatars of Vishnu. Why don't you continue with that thought?
Yeah, absolutely. And no, this is you know, this is really interesting that you brought up CERN with this, because it actually has a lot to do with it. But yeah, as I was saying, that man, where does the time go? I can't believe it's been an hour already.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's believed that 9 of these avatars have already happened, and there's still one to come. And you know what's really interesting is in 1877, Helena Blavatsky, you know, she published her book Isis Unveiled, and she actually interpreted the Dashavataras, or those avatars, as representing the progression of biological evolution. So that shows what kind of influence, you know, they have. And she lists out each avatar, you know, like the first one's the fish, and she says that, you know, that's the first class of vertebrates that evolved in water. You know, and so on and so forth. She goes through this whole thing. And then the last one, the one that's supposedly to come, which is called Kalki, she wrote that it's symbolizing advanced humans with great powers of destruction. Now, what's interesting about, why Vishnu's in, you know, connected with this whole CERN thing, whether the people that are operating that know that they're doing this or not, it might just be demonically inspired, or they might full well know what they're doing. I believe that they're trying to bring in this 10th, this last incarnation. And, this final incarnation, Kalki, it's understood as the final incarnation of Vishnu. And it said that he will ride a white horse with a sword that blazes like a comet. That already sounds a lot like Revelation, but it also sounds like the Islamic end time figure that is sometimes compared with, you know, the Antichrist, the Mahdi, especially concerning the white horse, and also you know, the biblical Antichrist, if you take that interpretation of the first horse meaning that, which, you know, I'm still on the fence about, but some do, and I get where that comes from. But you know, that's described as the rider of the white horse in chapter 6 of the book Revelation. It has the same type of characteristics. So I believe that whole opening dimensional doorways thing, however the end time figure is going to incarnate, or however that's going to happen, I think that that's what that symbolizes there, and why that specifically is there at CERN.
What are they up to these days? I haven't kept up with them, but I've just been hearing rumblings here and there that they are firing things up and more powerful and yada yada. What have you followed up on it at all? Have you been paying attention?
Yeah, that's basically about all I've heard too. There's not a whole lot of information. I've been looking to see. You know, the only thing I've really been able to find is that they're basically what you just said. They're planning on firing it up soon, and it's going to be bigger and more powerful, and what exactly that means, what they're going to do, what they're looking for, I'm not sure. I don't think a whole lot of that has been disclosed yet, but I definitely try to keep up on it, because it's, you know, it's interesting, and you know, I think that it plays at least some type of end times role. I'm not sure exactly what, but that might be what's used to bring all this stuff into our dimension, you know, at one of the ways.
Yeah, you know, 2,053 nuclear bombs, if I remember the number right, nuclear bombs have been exploded on this planet since the 40s.
Wow.
And that prompted me in my research for Archon Invasion Part 2 to believe that – and there were physicists and there are different people saying, you know, all this nuclear activity, I mean, we are renting holes. We're tearing the fabric of time and space.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you think about that, 2,053 nuclear bombs – and most of them exploded by the United States of America, and incidentally, and a whole lot of them in the Area 51, Nevada, you know, and New Mexico, White Sands, you know, that whole southwest area of the United States. Do you think that all this nuclear activity and CERN and things of that nature are strategically located, and these things were taking place at specific locations for specific reasons to bring back extra-dimensional entities?
Yeah, I believe so. I mean, it's definitely possible. And again, whether the ones in charge of handling all that, whether they consciously know it or not, because it might, you know, they might be doing it in ignorance. It could be a demonically influenced thing, but they very well might know exactly what they're doing, which seems to be the case. You know, at least the higher ups do.
Well, when you have characters like Jack Parsons and stuff,
yeah,
what they were into, you're like, okay, well, they were. You know, when you got Parsons and L. Ron Hubbard doing the Babylon working in the area that now became known as Area 51, you know, later, yep. They clearly had some kind of willful intent.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And that's why, you know, that's another way that these doorways are being ripped open is through the occult, through all these occult practices. You know, there are a lot of skeptics, you know, especially in our culture, that believe that there just really isn't anything to magic or witchcraft, and you know they're just wasting their time. But that stuff is real. It's real. It's demonic. It's evil. And you know there's no such thing as you know a good witch or white magic. It's all from the same evil source. But those types of things, and even New Age practices. You know I've talked about probably every time I've been on your show. You know I've mentioned astral projection and how I used to long before I was doing any of this, when I was still kind of an idiot, I used to, you know, practice in that stuff, not at all knowing what I was doing. I mean, I looking back on it, I can see how I was being demonically influenced. Mm-hmm. But I had no idea what I was doing. But every time that I was successful, I was ripping open a doorway or a portal between dimensions. I didn't know it at the time until stuff started spilling through and, you know, terrorizing my family and I. And, you know, that's a whole other story. But, and, you know, it was just by the authority and name of Jesus that those portals were able to be closed. But yeah, I mean, things like that, you know, they're not innocent. You know, I mean, I used to think, you know, well, I'm not hurting anybody by doing this, but actually I was hurting myself and my family. I just didn't know it. Same goes for all, you know, occult practices. And that is a way that these doorways are opened as well, as just like what, Jack Parsons and, Aleister Crowley and, you know, people like that were trying to do. Yeah, absolutely.
Hmm. In chapter 3, you talk about ancient technology. You know, in antiquity and the inception of extra-dimensional technology. Would you say the Tower of Babel was the first such structure in the post-flood world?
Yeah, in the post-flood world, definitely. And, I...
The way you answered that, in the post-flood world, definitely. Do you believe that the Tower of Babel was built on top of a pre-flood structural... in an area where there was some kind of pre-flood activity?
There was something special about that area. I don't know exactly what it was, but there was some reason that they built it there of all places. And you know, like you've even commented on, they had mountains all around. If it was just about height, they could have, you know, they could have utilized that, but they built it in a valley. So I believe there was something special about that location. Exactly what it was, I don't know. But I do believe that it's possible there was some, some type of pre-flood thing that happened there, or that might, you know, maybe if it was a technological thing, there might have been something left over that they utilized in the, you know, in the building, or I can only really speculate, but yeah, I believe that's a strong possibility.
Okay, so you got Nimrod and company, and they decide, okay, for whatever reason, this location's ideal to build something in the post-flood world. Take it from there. What do you think is going on there with the planes?
Well, I think that they were most likely trying to call back the fallen angels, or, you know, the extra dimensional beings. Book of Enoch talks a lot, Book of Jasher talk, well, Enoch too, but especially Jasher talks a lot about that, and gives a lot more information as to what exactly was going on. But it seems like they were trying to petition the fallen angels, and, you know, what's really interesting about that, let me find my, I gotta find my notes on this real quick. About the Tower of Babel, was what happened afterwards. I think that it really describes why we're in the position we're in today. Because I think a lot of skeptics of our type of research ask, well, you know, if these things are angels or if these things are demons, what would they care about our affairs? You know, why would they want to deceive an entire nation and, you know, do all these things? How did they get into a position where they could do such a thing? I actually think that in a way, in a roundabout kind of way, probably not in the way that he had in mind, I think Nimrod was successful, but, again, in more of an ironic kind of way. You know, I as I said before, I believe that Nimrod and the people of the world were trying to call back these fallen angels, really to try in their attempt to destroy God and, you know, set up their own gods in God's place. But what ended up happening, you know, is kind of ironic. This was really what got me away from the whole, I used to be, you know, years ago, I used to be like King James only. And this was one of the things that was brought to my attention that kind of got me out of that mindset and more accepting of other Bible translations. Deuteronomy 32:8, it's translated in the King James as, when the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel.
Yeah, which didn't show up till hundreds of years later.
Exactly, and that's the issue, is that the last word of that passage there is sons of Israel. And really, it should be translated as the sons of God, and the ESV has it that way. The ESV says, when the Most High gave to their nations their inheritance, when he divided mankind, he fixed the borders of the peoples according to the number of the sons of God. So that translation, and I believe it's in the Septuagint and things like that too, but that translation seems to make more sense when we consider the context of what's being talked about. It's talking about when God divided mankind, which refers back to the Tower of Babel. That's when that happened. The main reason the Sons of God translation makes more sense than Sons of Israel is, as you pointed out, at that time, there, you know, right after the Tower of Babel, there was no Israel. There were no children to be numbered. But there definitely were sons of God, or you know, what we would call angels. So the short version of that story states that, you know, the people of the world led by Nimrod built the tower in an attempt to enter heaven or petition the fallen angels. They worshiped those fallen angels as their gods. So when Yahweh dispersed the people and confused their languages, he did so according to the number of the fallen angels that were worshipped instead of him. And you know, some sources, I think Jasher says there were 70.
Yeah.
So it's basically as if God was saying, okay, you don't want to worship me, but you want these fallen angels as your gods. Then you can have them over you in your own nations, and let's see how well that works out for you. Yeah. But you know, the really cool thing about our God, about Yahweh, is that he's always offered free will to humans and always provided a way for humans to return to him if they so chose. So if that's the correct translation, that could help explain really the origin of all the world's religions, why there's so many different ones. It could explain why all other religions offer salvation by personal works, yet biblical text states that we can't attain our salvation on our own. We're in need of a savior. That could help explain the purpose of the formation of Israel. That verse immediately following what we looked at, we looked at Deuteronomy 32:8. Deuteronomy 32:9 says, "But the Lord's portion is His people, Jacob His allotted heritage." So the interpretation or translation of sons of God really just brings the whole thing together. God gave His people gave the people of the world what they wanted to. You know, they wanted to worship false and inferior gods. Yet He still had a plan for people to return if they would choose to do so, and that plan began with God taking His portion, Israel, beginning with Abraham, and later being born in the same lineage as their Savior, as the Savior of the people of the world required for eternal salvation, or Jesus Christ. So, I mean, it's phenomenal how one little thing like that, one word really from Israel and God, can really change the whole context of the verse and bring everything into sharper focus. That's that.
I looked at it as, because many ancient scholars and rabbis and whatnot have said that the languages were dispersed to 70 different people groups. And again, going back to Michael Heiser, he talks about the divine council of 70, and that, okay, here we go. We're going to split up everybody into 70. And Joshua said there's about 600,000 men on the planet at that time. So you've got theoretically maybe couple million people on the earth, are going to be separated into 70 different people groups. And it's, as I read that, and same thing, Septuagint, look at all these other ones, sons of God. Of course, King James says sons of Israel. I'm going, what? But it appears that, kind of piggyback on, Elie Marzulli's concept of a cosmic chess match, that God basically said, okay, let's divide them up into 70. I'll tell you what, Satan, you take 69, and I'll take, Eber and his group, for myself.
Yeah.
Give it your best shot. 69-1, give it your best shot. And of course you got all the different religions and different things that spun off from those 69. Meanwhile, God's just kind of playing with this one little group, the Hebrews, and calls Abraham out, and the rest of the story from there. But it is fascinating. So do you think that if there's nothing new under the sun and what has been will be again, do you think that we're going to see a revisitation of a Babel-like scenario, and where God says, okay, you want to play around with the fallen ones? Here you go.
Yeah, absolutely. And I believe that's even talked about in Zechariah, chapter 5. That actually gets into the whole scroll and ephah thing.
Yeah.
I always thought that was really interesting. I think some people, I've read a lot of different interpretations and everything, but I think some kind of missed the mark a little bit. And I'm not saying I have it all together or anything, because I certainly don't. I'm as flawed and human as the rest of them, but if not worse so. But a lot of people will look at the description of the scroll and they'll see a cigar shaped UFO there. I personally don't. I think that's a vision. I believe it's a literal scroll with an actual meaning, that on the surface doesn't really have much of anything to do with UFOs. I mean, in context, when you dig deeper into it, there might be something there. But with the ephah, though, I do think that that's representing a type of a craft.
Yeah.
And it directly relates back to Babel. The vision of the ephah, let's see. This is a lot to read. Let's see. It's in Zechariah, chapter 5, verses 5 through 11. I won't read all of it, but, it basically says that, there's an ephah that goes forth, and this is their resemblance throughout all the earth. That's what the angel is telling Zechariah. And it's described as wickedness. He says that this is there's a woman that sits in the middle of the ephah, and the angel says, this is wickedness. And he cast it into the midst of the ephah, and he cast the weight of lead upon the mouth thereof. And also interesting is it says that there are these two women. The wind was in their wings, for they had wings like the wings of a stork, and they lifted up the ephah between the earth and heaven. And this is where it's really interesting. Zechariah asked the angel, you know, where are these women taking this ephah? And the angel says, to build it a house in the land of Shinar, right, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base.
Yeah.
So that right there connects right back to, and the reason that I believe, the reason I think it's this ephah thing, you know, if you look at a picture of what an ephah looked like, it does resemble, you know, the flying saucer shape type of UFO, just in appearance. And, you know, it does say in the verse, this is their appearance throughout all the earth. So the reason I believe that it's set in that place in Shinar, because that was, in antiquity, that was the place of the original deception of the return of these fallen angels. So I believe that that's going to be revisited somehow. And I believe it's going to have something to do with the whole UFO phenomenon, alien gospel. I don't know exactly what or how it's all going to play out. I don't know if it's going to be, like how L.A. Merzulli describes, basically one day all these UFOs are going to show up. It could be that, or it might be something more gradual, like what Doug Woodward describes. It might be more gradual and subtle of a process. I don't know exactly how it's going to play out, but I do believe that those are the elements that are going to be involved in that deception. And that's how it ties back to, back to Shinar and the Tower of Babel, because they were trying to do the same thing. They were trying to call back, you know, the fallen angels, and we're doing that today. They might have a different name, you know, the world will call them extraterrestrials or aliens, but, you know, there are even reports of, occultists conjuring, gray aliens. And you know, if they're an extraterrestrial being, how can you conjure, how would that work anyway?
Are they just sitting around, walking around, Zeta Reticuli, and all of a sudden, oh, they get yanked out of their planet and manifest in your living room? I mean, what?
Yeah, exactly. And here's a creepy thing. I was just contacted by somebody. I won't mention her name, but it's somebody that I've talked to. You know, I keep in contact with one of my readers, and I've had contact with this individual for a year, maybe a couple years now. You know, it's just real basic stuff. You know, if she has a question, she'll ask, and I'll do my best to answer that kind of stuff. Well, the other night, she asked if, she asked what I knew, like if I knew anything about, like, casting demons out or something like that. And because she said that a friend of hers, is being oppressed by demons, and it's definitely demonic. And she talked to me a little bit about it, and I said, well, and you know, she basically said, she told me what she was telling her, you know, using the name of Jesus and all that. And I said, yeah, you're on the right track. And she said, well, here's the weird thing. My friend actually snapped a picture of one of these things through a window. I guess she was woken up by tapping on the window, and, she got her camera on her phone and took a picture to, you know, get a picture of this thing. She sent me the picture, and you can see a reflection in the glass of what looks like a gray alien. And I, you know, I've seen so many fake pictures and hoaxes. You know, I'm not an expert, and I'm sure that there are some that are really good that, you know, that I would even be fooled by, but I do not think this is one. I don't believe at all that this is an elaborate hoax. For one thing, I don't really see any benefit, you know, because this friend of the person that was talking to me has no idea that I'm even in the picture, you know. So yeah. what would be the benefit? But yeah, she sent me this picture, and I looked at it, and I just got a chill up and down my spine, and I was like, that. I don't understand how the world can look at something like that and think alien and not demon, you know. It's just intense. So that's kind of a tangent, but I just thought that was kind of interesting in what we're talking about. But, yeah, and you know, descriptions of demons, you either get like the typical like shadow people, like what you and I have dealt with and we've talked about, or a lot of times when people describe demons, they describe what the world would see as aliens. And then they say, oh, well, you were abducted by aliens. That's not a demon. That's an alien. Maybe that's what demons look like, or fallen angels even, you know. I believe they're two different things, but so that's where really why I wanted to deal with this whole extra dimensional thing, and to show that not only the craft are extra dimensional, but the creatures themselves are extra dimensional. That's how they're able to, you know, pull a person, like a three-dimensional solid person, through a three-dimensional solid wall. Only something that originates from a higher dimension has access to be able to do things like that. I kind of went off on a little bit of a tangent there.
No, that's great stuff, man. We got about a minute and a half before we go to break, but, when we come back, you've talked about sort of the connection, or reconnection as it were, possibly with, the plains of Shinar and Babylon. But you've got a section, it looks like, in Chapter 3 where you talk about the Great Pyramid and the Sphinx.
Yeah.
So are you implying an Egyptian connection as well?
Yeah, definitely. We'll talk about that. And then do not let me forget, I'll go through that briefly because I want to tell you about the topographical spacemen. You're going to love this.
Okay. Yeah, cool. So we'll talk about the Sphinx and the Great Pyramid and kind of your take on that. What do you mean by topographical spacemen? What does the phrase mean? You could describe it more afterwards.
Yeah, it's, basically, have you the Nazca lines?
Oh.
The one that's called the giant sometimes, or, yeah, you know, it's called the spaceman. Well, yeah, that was made by man. That's man-made. There are images like that that are naturally made.
Really?
Yeah, and, this, I was apprehensive to even include this in the book because it's so out there. It's so weird. But I do believe that there's something there. And I put images in the book. I'll get all into detail when we get back from the break. But I know you, with the research that you've done, you'll really appreciate it.
Okay. Well, very good. We'll go to break right now and we'll come back on the final section of the broadcast. We'll talk about topographical species.
Radio with Tom Barnes and Tommy Whitgay, Saturdays on True Frequency Radio.
And we're back for this final segment of the Revolutionary Radio Project broadcast for tonight. I'm your host, Rob Skiba, and we're talking with Josh Peck. And right before the break, you sort of teased us with this idea of topographical spacemen. There's actually four questions I want you to see if you can possibly try to get to as best you can in this last segment. First is dealing with Egypt's pyramids and Sphinx. Second, the topographical spacemen. And what does Mount Hermon have to, and Roswell have to do with Orion? And then finally, we'll let people know where we can get your books.
Yeah, absolutely. There's so much information. It's gonna, I'll do my best to pack it into a half hour, but, it's so interesting and fascinating. Well, a good place to, before we get into the spaceman stuff, the whole Egypt thing, because it's a little shorter. I mean, actually, you could do a whole study on just that, and you have, so you know. Speaking about that, did you end up getting that book I recommended to you, the by Noah Hutchings, the Great Pyramid?
I did. Yes, I did.
Good.
I got it probably a week or two after I did my conference on the subject, and then I just said, okay, I'm going to put it in. When actually, no, I. Well, I got it right before I did the conference because I actually referred to it during the conference.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, I'm glad that you got that. Because I remember the last time you were on my show, we just barely – this was when you were still looking in. I think you had just the first part
the blog.
Of the blog.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and I remembered that book, and I thought, oh, that'd be perfect. But yeah, I'm glad that you got it and was able to reference it. I referenced it
in the presentation.
Awesome, that's awesome. Yeah, I referenced it as well in my book because it's a little book, but it's just filled with information. But anyway, yeah. So getting to that whole thing, You know, we know from Enoch and Genesis that before the flood, the fallen angels, you know, brought all these sorts of, you know, wisdom and secrets and, you know, you could even say technology. Enoch says things like, you know, Semyaza taught enchantments and root cutting and Amoros, the resolving of enchantments. And, you know, it goes through that whole list. So we know where that originally that's where those come from. But what's really interesting is that Josephus actually says something about that and gives some more information. Josephus writes, meaning the children of Seth, also were the inventors of that peculiar sort of wisdom which is concerned with the heavenly bodies and their order, and that their inventions might not be lost before they were sufficiently known upon Adam's prediction that the world was to be destroyed at one time by the force of fire and at another time by the violence and quantity of water, they made two pillars, one of brick, the other of stone. They inscribed their discoveries on them both, that in case the pillar of brick should be destroyed by the flood, the pillar of stone might remain and exhibit those discoveries to mankind, and also inform them that there was another pillar of brick erected by them. Now this remains in the land of Syria or Egypt to this day. So even in the day of Josephus, that remained there. Now in Jubilees, it says, it kind of builds a little bit from that, and it says, and he, meaning Canaan, found a writing which former generations had carved on the rock, and he read what was thereon, and he transcribed it and sinned owing to it, for it contained the teaching of the watchers in accordance with which they used to observe the omens of the sun and moon and stars and all the signs of heaven. So if all those accounts are to be taken as factual, that might help fill in some blanks and answer some interesting questions about the Sphinx and Great Pyramid. Now, when we just take that account of Josephus and Jubilees, there's not like a whole lot of information given about those pillars of the children of Seth. You know, we're told that there were two pillars, one of brick and one of stone. They weren't sure if the pillar of brick would be destroyed by the flood. So in case it was, they built the pillar of stone and inscribed their discoveries on both. We're told that at least the pillar of stone remained in Egypt, at least in the days of Josephus. We're also told that those pillars contained the teachings of the watchers, and it was considered sinful to follow those teachings. So that begs the question, is there anything in Egypt that we might be able to compare to this? Now, this is speculative, but I think it's still interesting. I'm not saying that this is historical or scientific or anything. This is just kind of me thinking in my own book, so I'm allowed to do that. But I believe that there's a possibility that the two pillars could actually be the Great Pyramid, or at least the capstone, and what is now the Great Sphinx in Egypt. Author and researcher Robert M. Schock has postulated, due to the evidence of water erosion, that the Great Sphinx in Giza is actually far older than most would suspect, and that a catastrophe of some kind destroyed any other evidence of an older civilization. His research was showcased in the 1993 documentary Mystery of the Sphinx, which was actually presented by Charlton Heston. It's a pretty interesting documentary. If people want to check that out, it's free on YouTube. That's where I found it. But in that documentary, the idea is put forth that the Sphinx was originally nothing more than a large natural stone jutting from the earth. and an unknown civilization saw the stone and decided to carve into it, yet what they carved originally is also unknown. So after the unknown civilization was destroyed, a new civilization arrived and carved the stone into the figure of a head, and then also a body was dug out and formed, you know, from the ground underneath, and that's how the Sphinx was created. So that's Shock's research. He's not coming at this from a biblical perspective or anything like that. That's just what he's, you know, based on the water erosion and things like that. So if there's any validity to that, that might help explain the pillar of stone that contained the teaching of the Watchers. It's possible that the stone that was found originally, the natural stone jutting from the earth, was inscribed with those teachings, and then the flood came. Later civilizations then, for reasons unknown, maybe because of what Canaan did, whatever he did, later civilizations removed the inscriptions by carving the stone down to the image of the head of the Sphinx, and then they could have created the body to form a complete cherub-like statue, and that, you know, that's what we're looking at. It's a cherub in order to protect something, because, you know, as we talked about earlier, that's the job of the cherub, to protect something. And it might have been to protect those secrets of whatever Canaan did to sin, you know, according to those, it was something bad enough for it to be recorded in Jubilees and things. But that could be the pillar of stone. Now, the pillar of brick might be the Great Pyramid, but specifically the missing capstone. Now, there's a lot of information and speculation that could be, you know, looked at in regards to the Great Pyramid, and you certainly have done way more than I have in that area. And it's from what I've heard in your presentation, it's absolutely fascinating. But we could look at that. There is a theory that the Great Pyramid could be made of brick and not quarried from stone. And if the builders were unsure if it would survive the flood, it might make sense that they would inscribe the teaching of the Watchers at the very top, or the capstone. Now, stating that the Great Pyramid is made from brick and not quarried stone is controversial, but there is some good research into that and some good explanations on why people believe that, and I include a link to a blog in the book. But anyway, so that now what exactly happened to the capstone, whether why it's missing today or if it's still in existence somewhere, that's up for debate. But it might have been carried away with the flood and buried somewhere in the ocean, you know, who knows. But so now when we're, you know, talking about possibilities like that, there's a lot of theories. Yeah, but I do believe that some truth can be found somewhere in between all those theories, and at the very least, it's intriguing, it's interesting. There's a wide variety of resources, you know, your work and also what the book I mentioned before, The Great Pyramid, Prophecy in Stone by Noah Hutchings is a great resource. But that, in a nutshell, is how the pyramid and Sphinx might connect to those two pillars.
Okay. Yeah, I met Robert Shock. He's a really cool guy, actually. He's a really down-to-earth guy. We had a lot of very interesting conversations. He was one of the speakers at that conference I was at in New Jersey.
Oh, awesome.
So we spent quite a bit of time together at the host's house and out at restaurants and stuff like that. We had a lot of interesting conversations. But he's just a really cool guy. All right, so topographical spacemen.
Yeah. So this was something that I didn't really know that it was this research was going to take this turn until it did. I originally was just looking into the Nazca lines because I know that is used in ancient astronaut theory, you know, as evidence to support it. And I just wanted to look into it and see what was, you know, just see what was there. But basically the Nazca lines, they're in southern Peru. They're north of the town of Nazca, and it's an expanse of desert that has geoglyphs. They're just basically really large images that are carved into the terrain. You know, they depict different types of animals, like there's a monkey and a hummingbird and a spider, and they seem to be best, it seems to be that they're best seen from the sky. But there's one that has had a lot of special attention because, It's a humanoid figure. It's called the Spaceman. Sometimes it's called the Giant, which I think is interesting. But ancient astronaut theory will say that, it is showing an alien of some kind. Cause, you know, it does look kind of weird. It has an oddly shaped head. You know, there's features of it, and there's a lot of speculation, for why the original crafters of those geoglyphs would include that strange design. I include pictures of all this stuff in the book, it looks like it's a humanoid figure with a vertical line running from its feet to, the bottom of its head, and it has its right arm raised, its left arm is down, and it has a really strange shaped head. Like it's just this weird, like, kind of bulbous head with two big eyes. People can look up, you know, Nazca Spaceman and get pictures of it, you know. But anyway, so keep that in mind. Now this actually, this is something that I, builds off of some of your research that I first saw years ago, I think it was the Mount Herman Roswell connection, your presentation DVD. You had a picture of Mount Herman on there, and you showed how you just briefly, you know, just mentioned it, but you showed how the topography of Mount Herman actually has the shape of a goat's head.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then you talked about Azazel and all that stuff in connection with that, and how that was the site of the original 200 Watchers, that, you know, that whole thing. I thought that was pretty interesting. And, you know, when I find a researcher I like, or like, you know, a DVD or something, I have the bad habit of watching it over and over and over and over again. And that was the DVD that I did that with. And, just over time, that image, you know, I saw the goat head, and, you know, I referenced that in the book, but I also saw something else in there too. When I first noticed it, I really didn't know what to do with it, and I really didn't even pay any attention to it for a couple of years, because I thought it was just too speculative. But if you look at people who want to look at the coordinates of this, it's in Google Earth. It's 33 degrees 27.38.21 north and 36 degrees 04.29.65 east. That's where you can see this thing. If you look at like just the top part of the head where it's, I guess it would be its ear, kind of sticks out. When you look at the ear itself, it actually has facial features. And if you zoom in on it, it looks like an elongated skull. And, you know, there's two eyes, a mouth, and there's even a nose. And then, The goat head itself has a darkened shaded area on the top that actually forms this thing's body. And, you know, when I first noticed that, like I said, I didn't really know what to do with it. I thought it was just too speculative. But the main important thing too is that, in that shaded area, the body of this thing, its right arm is raised. So when I was looking into Nazca, you know, a couple of years later, after I saw that, that reminded me of the right arm being raised thing. And I thought that, you know, I was like, well, that's an interesting coincidence. I'm not sure if there's enough there. So I, in your DVD, and I know Dave Flynn, did a lot of extensive research into this, into a connection between, Mount Herman and Roswell. So I thought, okay, well, there's a good way to test if there's anything there. I do believe that there is a connection between those two places. If there really, you know, if there really is this naturally made spaceman thing that looks a lot like the one in Peru, except it has an elongated skull, there should be one in Roswell too, and it should be noticeable. So I looked at on Google Earth, I looked at the topography of Roswell, and I wish you had a video show so I could show these images because they're.
I'm on Google Earth right now.
Okay.
I'm intrigued. You got a location for me?
Yeah. Okay. Roswell, New Mexico. It's 33 degrees, 49.21.98 north, and then 103 degrees, 49.23 west. So Roswell should be at that, like, the bottom portion, you know, of the screen. And if you look up, standing above Roswell, it looks like there's this topographical image of, what looks to me like a little gray alien with its right arm raised. And I have, I have the outline. I think it's a river or something, from Roswell, you follow that up, that forms the left side of its body. And from there, I mean, it's pretty prominent. I mean, there's even big eyes in this thing. Are you there? Are you able to see it?
I got Roswell highlighted there, and then up above that is some dark green pastures and agricultural stuff.
You might have to zoom out a lot.
North airport.
Let me see if I can find what the altitude was. I should have recorded that. You probably have to zoom out quite a bit. Let me see here. I'm going to try to find the, the altitude is, I can't quite make it out.
I'm at 3569.
Let me try to zoom in here. I have this image on my other, I do have it on this laptop. Let me pull it up real quick so I can actually see what the altitude is. Cause it's one of those things, once you see it, you can't unsee it. okay, let me.
Google Earth is fun, man.
Oh yeah, I like playing around on that.
Yeah.
See, Roswell.
Of course, it's kind of like looking at clouds, you know, you can kind of see like, you know.
Alright.
Whatever.
Yeah, elevation is 4,279 feet. Eye altitude is 160.69 miles.
160.69. Oh, you're way out.
Yeah, yeah, you gotta zoom out quite a bit. It's big.
Okay. I see like the river going up.
Yeah, if you forms the left side of its body, and especially where it curves out, that's its head. And if you follow that around, it actually formed, you know, it forms the shape of his head, and then you can see its right arm is raised. I have an outline of it in the book. Like, I have a picture of just the natural topography, and then I have an outline of it that shows in a little bit more detail. And if you actually look inside of the head too, you can even see two eyes. Are you able to? Are you seeing what I'm seeing?
I'm not sure that I am, but I don't want to take up too much of your time trying to figure
that out.
So you can send me pictures on Facebook or whatever later.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Well, I even have the pictures in my blog, joshpeckdisclosure.blogspot.com. Scroll down to the topographical spaceman and you can even see some pictures there. I have some of the information, for that chapter in that blog, but I have way more in the actual chapter itself. Going back to the, what that actually
ties it to, Orion.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So once I saw those details and I wanted to test myself to make sure I just wasn't seeing things. You know, I wanted to make sure I was actually there. So I sent it to some other people that I trust, you know, other researchers, and they saw it too. And, I looked in other areas where I thought maybe there would be something. You know, I looked at the site of the Phoenix light, didn't find anything. I looked other UFO sites. I found nothing. I must have looked in 20 different. So I even looked on Mars and on the moon and stuff. Nothing. Yeah. So, you know, after I didn't find, I was like, okay, maybe I'm not just seeing things here, because it seems like I'd just be seeing them everywhere if I was. But anyway, so the interesting thing is that there's one in Peru there that's man-made. But then there's the one in Roswell and the one in, on Mount Hermon that are naturally made or made by something else. So what that has to do with, Orion, I noticed a similarity of the Orion constellation and these images. Orion's right arm is raised, basically. And, another interesting thing is, it's not in a lot of star charts and stuff. It isn't always mentioned, but there's a star called the Omega Star that's right in the middle of Orion's upper torso. And if you follow that trail of stars down, it actually bisects Orion in half, just like the Nazca that has the vertical line in the spaceman itself, the vertical line. So. Now, how I think that connects is, just besides the physical attributes, having the right arm raised and everything, I think that when we look at the history of what actually happened at Mount Hermon and Roswell, these are both times where something that I would say extra-dimensional came into contact with physical Earth and humanity. And really made a big deal. Roswell was huge. And of course, Mount Hermon was as well. I think the Orion constellation, is a type of prophecy of another time that this is going to happen in the future. But this time it's going to bring the end time figure, the Antichrist figure, maybe a reincarnation of Nimrod because, and this also goes in line with your research and what we talked about before, the division of the languages, the nations would have called Nimrod by different names. Orion's one of them. So I believe that this might be a prophetic statement in the stars. And then I wrote a whole chapter on prophecies in the stars and things actually. So there's validity there, that shows a return of, not only extra-dimensional beings, but also of the end-time Antichrist figure, and I believe that those images are imprinted in the topography because that's where those happened, and having the same right arm raised as Orion, I believe that that's a prophetic warning. That this is going to happen again. Now why the right arm is raised and why the bisecting line, I can only speculate. I think that the line that bisects it might have something to do with like a hybrid of some sort, part human, part possibly extra dimensional or, alien kind of thing. There's a lot of different theories about that. Why the right arm is raised, I believe might have something to do with paying homage to this thing or showing allegiance. You could even look back to Hitler and the whole Nazi salute. Mm-hmm. The right arm was raised, and, I even have a picture in the book of Hitler giving that salute, and he's wearing a coat that long coat that the line of the coat bisects his body in half. So, it's just kind of interesting parallels, but, I do see Hitler as a type or shadow of Antichrist. I believe he was afflicted by the spirit of Antichrist. So all those things put together, it's speculative, of course, but I think that it's pointing to something that's going to happen in probably our near future.
All right. Well, we got 1 minute left. So where can people, get your book and contact you, and look into your research?
Absolutely. They can go to ministudyministry.com. I have my book up on there. It's now available in ebook formats as well. And to get a hold of me, my email is joshpeckdisclosure@gmail.com. I highly encourage anybody to write me and get a hold of me. I will answer back. And also I'm really active on Facebook, probably more than I should be. So there's that too.
Well, I know what that's like. Well, hey, Josh, thanks so much for coming on again. It was great talking with you.
Yeah, it was good talking to you too. Thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely. And, that's all the time we have for tonight. So thank you guys so much for listening to the Revolutionary Radio Project. We'll see you back here next week. Good night, everybody.